See you next one. It's rock and roll.
In our ongoing series about the two issues affecting play right now with the NCAA extending eligibility and also the contraction of the draft and contraction possibly of minor league baseball and how all this has been affected by the COVID. Today we have a friend of mine, someone I've known for, gosh, I guess about 10 years, Dan Gooley. Dan has 34 years as a D1 head coach. He was a head coach. And I can never remember the order of this, but Hartford first? Was it Hartford first?
No, I was at Quinnipiac College first, Carl. I started there in 1971.
Okay.
And I coached there for 16 years. Then I left and went to the University of Hartford for 5 years. Then I took a little hiatus from the coaching side of the house.
That's right.
And I was recruited to the Starter Corporation by a dear friend, the CEO and president of Starter, David Beckerman. And I was the director of Major League Baseball, Minor League Baseball, and the top 25 college baseball teams in the country.
Wow.
And I did that for 6 years. Then I returned back to Quinnipiac in 1989. And I finished my career there in 2015.
Okay, so Dan knows quite a bit. He knows a lot of people. He has a lot of experience. And to be honest with you all as viewers, we used to interact with each other a lot at college level tryouts and everything. And I was always gravitated to him because he was honest and blunt, and I looked him up because of that. Those same character issues right now. He doesn't have a dog in the fight. He's not trying to bamboozle anybody for a scholarship or anything. He's going to be very blunt and honest with. And I think that that's what this time period requires. If you really want to play baseball in college, you can't make mistakes right now. You've got to be informed. So. And Dan, you and I have talked about this. I think that a lot of kids and their parents, they don't understand levels of play, what is required to be a D. They all want to play D1, but they don't know the difference between what is required. They don't understand how their sport sits in the priorities of their decision. You know, that education comes first, that money, finances, geography, do you want to live close to home or far away, the social environment of the school, are you going to be happy, and baseball boils down to opportunity. Are you going to be given a chance to play, and are you going to, and develop, there's a big word, development. And they don't understand that it isn't just, the thing that there's a disconnect, I find, is that every athlete feels that they're the best. Everybody does, and they. Yeah, but how does the other part in that equation perceive you? And I don't think that kids understand that there are literally quantitative elements, you know, that dictate where they get placed. But let's start today. What we want to do for all of you out there is we want to develop a series, particularly with Dan, so you guys can call in and if you have some questions. But let's start with all this COVID stuff. And not only are you a veteran of this, but you're connected with a lot of guys right now, right? I know you still are in touch with Jim Penders at UConn, and you talk about this stuff virtually on a daily basis. So my first question is, in broad terms, how is this going to affect competition? And I mean, not only in terms of UConn playing Florida or whatever, but how is this going to affect competition for roster spots and particularly for scholarships? Can you comment on that?
Well, you know, the COVID-19 series virus has been absolutely devastating throughout this, not only the world, this country, but here in Connecticut. And the athletic baseball side of the house, unfortunately, we've lost an entire college season. We've lost an entire high school season. We are about to lose an entire American Legion season. It's really going to come down to maybe the Futures League and the Connecticut College Baseball League in Connecticut with Tim Vinson. Might very well be the only college leagues available this summer. And, you know, the piece to the COVID that is very difficult is the timing, because our college coaches can't go out and recruit until June 1st. Saying that to you, you know, this is all going to lead, this is all going to lead to what seniors in the NCAA Division I, II, and III, because of the lost season in the spring, all seniors are going to be asked to come back if they'd like to return to the universities that they played at. They're going to get another full year of school.
Just for that, they have to be asked back, or is it the choice of the coach whether an individual is invited?
Well, it's going to be a combination of both, actually. You know, they're going to be able to turn around, make a decision with their families that they would like to return back to school, get in touch with their head baseball coach, and then the player and his families and a head coach will sit down and figure out what is the very best possible alternative that I have for myself this year. You know, if you're a senior player and you're sitting here and you've just graduated from your college, you've got to have a reason academically why you're coming back to school.
Right.
Am I going to get a second major out of this in 12 months? Am I going to get a master's degree out of this in 12 months?
Right. Exactly.
You know, after that piece is developed and you looked at the competitive piece, you know, if you and I are senior players and we have played together for four years, and we're going back to play at our institution and we were all starters, we're probably going to get the first shot at being a starter on the club for next year. Now, that in itself is going to backlog every player. All the juniors are going to be backlogged. The sophomores will be backlogged. And the young freshman players that are coming in, they are going to be backlogged.
Well, I want to interrupt you there, because I've had a couple of discussions with clients, and I say, look, suppose that I'm making this up, but suppose that Jim Penders had recruited me as a third baseman. Mm-hmm. And he says, I'm going to give you a partial.
Mm-hmm.
And then secondarily, he says, by the way, the starting third baseman is graduating, so you've got a shot to see considerable playing time as a freshman. Now, all of a sudden, that's out the window.
Yes, that probably could be a chance to demonstrate your patience and your perseverance. Yes, that's very true. That returning starting third baseman who just graduated is returning, and he's going to get the first chance to play. He definitely is, because Jim Penders or any other coach is going to be loyal to that young kid. And then, you know, the rosters are going to fill up. There's no question about that. You could be looking at a roster of maybe 8 senior players that have just graduated that are maybe 6 want to return. So instead of having 35 guys on your roster, you might wind up turning around and having 41 or 40 players.
Wow. Wow.
Now, the other piece to this is that is very difficult, which has to be handled, is the financial side of the house. What's going to happen with the COVID when we are granted an additional year of play? The institution has the deciding right to issue you your scholarship money or not. So if you are the athletic director and you turn around and you have 5 players coming back and 5 players are on scholarship money, that decision is going to be made between the athletic director and the administration on whether or not you are going to receive your aid for next year. They have the deciding right. They can issue you your scholarship money. Yes, they can. And that will not go towards your total allotment that you are given to by the NCAA. They also can turn around and say to you, we'd love to have you back, but you are not going to receive any scholarship money whatsoever. You know, so it's all based on the institution's decision on how they're going to handle their players.
Now, this goes to issues that you and I have talked about a lot of times. You know, the current industry out there is a there's a mutual friend, Alberto Martinez, who was the head of player development for the Bluefish. He calls this the Make-A-Wish Foundation with some of these academies and everything. And you know, they all want to hear things like, we'd love to have you come and try out. What is a preferred walk-on status?
Correct.
And what I encourage players is geez, that's really worthless, to be honest with you. You're much better off going to that D3 program where they go, you're the man. We want you. What everything that you're talking about implies that basically there's going to be fewer jobs out there, and they're precarious, and they've really got to make blunt decisions about what the opportunities there are for them as individuals and for themselves as a family member.
Carl, you're going to this is 2020 we're in right now. You're a senior. You have already made a commitment. You may have made a commitment at the end of your junior year to attend a university. And now you are faced with the fact in 2 months, 2.5 months, you're going to start at a school that you've already signed your letter of intent for. So you now have to really seriously consider and call that head coach back and say, listen, how many of those senior guys are coming back? You know, because we have to make a decision if I'm coming forward with you. And he has to be as blunt to you as I would be with any player and tell the truth, because this is a vital information that has to be decimated.
No, I know.
And hopefully.
I know in good times. A couple of years ago, I had a kid that was coming from a D2 program. By the way, just FYI, I'm sure you know this, that a lot of these transfers are transfers down. In other words, they may be a D1 player and they go to a D2 program where they feel they have more opportunity for playing time. But I had a very good Division II level player. And I remember a conversation I had with another Division II program. He was an outfielder. And thank God that the good school for him in many respects, local, good business school, good program, and the head coach was very blunt. He says, Carl, I got 15 outfielders. You know, there's no opportunity for him here. And that's really, you know, I said, thank you. You know, that's what you need. You need to have that blunt conversation. Now, I'm going to ask you, and what this all means is it means two things. Pardon me if I look at my papers here. I should put them on the computer rather than constantly looking to the side. But what it means is that you've got to make, you can't make decisions based on hope. You've got to make decisions based on blunt. There's going to be fewer jobs, and they're going to have to get very blunt information in order to make a decision on that.
There's no question about that, Carl. You know, if you're going to turn around and you're going to be a young kid going into a program next year, you know, you're going to have the conversation with the head coach of, you have to realize I'm a good player. I know I'm a good player. I'm a good player because you recruited me. We're going to have a backup. I'm a very patient guy. I will persevere. If I earn my stripes on the field, am I going to get a chance to play next year? Or am I going to have to wait a year in order to play? And if he tells you the honest truth, then you have to make decisions on what's best for you, you know? But I can see, you know, the problem that you're going to have next year is that guys are going to be waiting in line to get a chance to play because you're going to have rosters that are going to be between 32 and 40 guys. And, you know, once you get into play, you don't make a lot of changes. You really don't. You know, you'll make your player changes every now and then, but you're trying to win a game. Your nine best guys are going on the field. And it could be a long season for the first year guys.
All right. You know, one thing that we have been very successful with, and it is impact this course of action is impacted by a lot of things. It's impacted by grades sometimes. It's impacted by, I hate to say it, but it's a blunt truth, level of maturity of the player. But we've been 100% successful when we have encouraged players to take a gap year. You know, if there are, because you, you know, one thing that I learned a long, long time ago in baseball is, boy, you know, downtime is an opportunity. That's an opportunity to get better. You know, if there, whatever I'm doing, if there's a, whatever it is, downtime, off season, that's my chance to get better. So this does not have to, I know a lot of people are whining and moaning about this, but it can be a good thing. There can be opportunities that you're even unaware of that can come out of this as a plus. Mm-hmm. Do you agree with that?
Well, yeah. You know, the gap year is a very interesting concept because on the college level, at the Division I level, in college hockey in this country, it's done all the time. A kid leaves high school hockey here in Connecticut, and he might very well be the best player in the state of Connecticut. He's got to spend 2 years in Canada playing at the junior A's. So when you're a freshman in college, coming in at 19 years old, if you went straight to school, now you're going to be 2 years out, which is your gap year. So you're going to be 21 years old, 20 to 21 years old to start your college career. So that is done all the time. My feeling would be, if I'm going to take a gap year, I have got to find somebody I trust. I've got to find somebody who's a great teacher, who I surely trust. I trust his judgment. I trust his teaching. I trust his evaluations. And I trust his recommendations on what I'm doing with my life going forward athletically. This has nothing to do with the academic piece. The academic piece has already been determined. I'm a very good student. I can read and write. I can add, subtract, multiply, and divide. I'm talking about, I'm taking this gap year to develop my maturity level. I may be taking this gap year to develop my physical level. I may be taking this gap year to get a master's degree in baseball from someone that I trust.
I'm gonna. Are you a hockey fan?
Oh, I love college hockey. Sure.
Do you by chance remember Pat Hickey played for the Rangers?
I remember the name. Yes.
One of my best friends, and he came out of that junior system in Canada. Sure. Yep. And his son, boy, you know what? Now, this is a couple of years ago. I remember I made some calls to Quinnipiac about his son. He's a very close friend of mine. Mm-hmm. And you're 1,000% right. I have to tell you, the thing that is amazing to me is in the current system, which is all these academies and travel ball, mm-hmm. they ignore development, that you know where you are and where you're and getting to where you're going to be. And I think that, and I'm not going to name names, but I am going to be blunt, there's too much incentive for these people. You know, if a family is spending $6,000-$10,000 in a program, for them to not be detailed about the truth about what is required at that next level. And people don't understand there is something really required at that next level, that you're not, there is a reason that it's D3, D1, you know, D2, and you may be a fine ball player. I've got a kid right now. He had a growth spurt of, went from 5'11 to 6'5. Okay, so he's.
Yeah, that sounds like a pretty good growth spurt, I'll tell you that much.
So he, well, you know, you hear about guys like Scottie Pippen with, you know, in basketball. Mm-hmm. So all of a sudden, he's walking around right now like a puppy with big feet. You know, so he hasn't figured out his new body. And he hasn't filled out. He's skinny. So he throws, I think he tops at 84, and he probably sits at around 82 to 80. And he's not getting any love from the D1 schools.
Right.
And I told him, geez, you know, don't be afraid to go to a Division III program. Fill out. You know, you have a shot of picking up, getting to 90, but don't, you know, go and compete someplace. Learn how to keep learning how to pitch. People forget stories like Tom Seaver. Mm-hmm. Tom Seaver didn't make his high school team until he was a senior.
Yeah, that's correct.
Ended up going to a JUCO.
Yep.
And then went to Southern Cal. You know, I was thunderstruck. I'm watching this thing on the Bulls right now. Scottie Pippen, listen to it. Have you watched that thing?
I have watched it, yes.
Scottie Pippen was the equipment manager.
I know, I saw that. Imagine that. Here's one of the greatest players in the NBA, and he's an equipment manager.
At an NAIA high school team. Not even an NCAA school, NAIA school.
Yeah.
Now, all these parents, you know, these high school players, they just get crazy. That system is based on winning games. Most of those programs sell enrollment in those programs on winning games. And I said, I told kids, I said, oh, so let me get this straight. So your team goes and wins a tournament. So the head coach of North Carolina is going to walk in the dugout. And he goes, great, scholarships for everybody.
Yeah. Doesn't happen.
No, it's you as an individual. And if you have the numbers, if you have the wherewithal, and you can get, you know, they all want to win. And a good, intelligent coach will, you know, certainly with some of that kind of potential, they'll find a spot for you. But I also like what you said, you know, this is our, to be honest, this is our whole program, but you're 1,000% right. You got to look for a professional that will tell you the truth, not what you want to hear.
That's correct.
Not you know, what
you get to a situation, you know, when you talk about developing levels of play. When you're a high school player, you have got to show that you dominate where you play. You could play in any high school in the state of Connecticut today. You have to show that you can dominate at your level. Now, are you the most dominating player on your high school team? Yes, I am. Now, let's match you up. Are you the most dominating player in your league?
Right.
Well, maybe. Well, you have to be. Now I'm going to turn around and I'm going to ask you, are you the most dominating player in the state of Connecticut? Now we're talking about a kid who not only is a major college player, potentially a major college player, he also is a legitimate possible draft choice at a professional level. But there's a level for each kid. In the game of baseball, there's a school for you to play at. It's just a question of where your skill level is and where you dominate at.
You know, in all the years I've been doing this, I have never had a kid where I've sat down and very graciously said, I'm sorry, Bobby, Timmy, Tommy, Fred, Stevie, you can't play baseball. I've never had that.
Right.
You know, exactly. What you may, but you have to adjust. You have to consider your own developmental rate of acceleration with your own development. And you have to find a place that you can play now. And it's funny because I'm going to do a subsequent interview with my friend Lou Lopez. Lou was a 20-year pro.
Mm-hmm.
Up and down in the major leagues. He was at Coastal Carolina.
Great school.
As a player, yes, at Coastal Carolina. Did not get drafted. Went into the independent leagues. played in St. Paul, mm-hmm. and got signed out of St. Paul and worked his way up into the major leagues. Mm-hmm. And it, you know, I have sent several players to independent ball. I sent a kid out last year to the Pecos League, and with no deference, the Pecos League is probably one of the lesser competitive independent leagues.
Yes, it is.
And you know, he went, he thought he was doing okay, a couple of hits and being, you know, whatever. And he got released. He called me up and he's furious. He doesn't understand what happened. I said to him, especially in those independent leagues, there's always somebody looking for your job. Mm-hmm. There's always somebody looking for your job. And so if you don't show on a daily basis that you can dominate, they're going to replace you.
No question.
Period.
There's no question about that.
Period.
You know, it always, you know, when you talk about dominating at the level you're at, for me, it always starts with the things you can control. And the number one thing that you can control is your attitude and your work ethic. You know, when I was finishing up my last 5 or 6 years, the key ingredient for me was when I recruited guys, I always asked this very simple question to a player. Who's the hardest working player on your high school team? If he hesitates to say the right answer, then I got the wrong kid. Who's the hardest working player on your team? Who's the hardest working player on your club? I am. Who's the hardest working player in your league? I am. Who's the hardest working team in our league? We are. You know, it all comes down to you accepting that challenge of your work ethic. Once you garner that work ethic and you demonstrate that every day, somewhere along the line, your talent is going to catch up to you and it's going to show.
You know something, we've done this. I started this, oh gosh, it may be as long as 10 years ago. It's certainly 7 years ago when I used to run into you at these tryouts.
Correct.
And now when somebody walks into my office and says, I want to play college baseball, it's a parallel question. The first thing I ask them is, you do know this is 5 hours a day. Yeah, this is not high school ball. This is not, I'm going to take 10 swings and stand in the outfield with my buddies and tell jokes.
No.
This is 5 hours a day. And if you really want to excel, it's going to be 7 to 8 hours a day.
Correct. Strength and conditioning programs.
And if you're not willing to do that, and I always say, that's okay.
Sure it is.
It really is. Yeah. Some people aren't cut out for that, but don't buy this gobbledygook that some of these academies are telling you that it's something that you can buy. This is the reality. There's the Grand Canyon between what they perceive and what that reality is.
That's correct.
And you've got to, and I'll tell you something else that I do psychology, mental skills, peak performance. I'll tell you something that I noticed right away when we started doing this more full time. You know, when you tell people, except someone like you that understands this, when you tell this to people, they don't believe you. Mm. But I swear to God that the most important ingredient in success is this and this.
No question.
It's intelligence. It's passion. It's work ethic. I can't tell you what. We have placed something like 60 kids with the process of evaluation, teach, train, and then place them in an appropriate program. And we've had pro ball, we've had All-American, All-Conference, everything else. Mm-hmm. And you know what's interesting, Dan, is of those 60 kids, I'll bet you all of them were from the Island of Lost Toys. You know, they were not at the right place. They weren't in. But boy, oh boy, if you have that heart, if you'll work I had a kid today. I said, it takes no talent to hustle. Coach says 60-yard dash, be first in line. Yeah, whatever it says, Work hard, be fast, show them where your head and your heart is. And it's amazing. This game, another game that, you know, like football, the fast guy, the strong guy, the big guy always has an edge. In this guy game, it's this and this. And I'm so glad you said that, because you want a key to success? That's the key to success in this
game. It's all about your work ethic, Carl. It is. And it's your ability to handle that work ethic in a very positive way. You know, if you're gonna be a player, if your qualities as a player, you hit with power, run, throw, catch, are fair, decent, good, solid.
Yes,
good, solid quality value. You can turn around and you can jump another half level or a whole level, just on your ability and your work ethic. You know,
it's valuable. You know what I tell kids? I said, in this game, 5% is huge.
Oh, sure, that's absolutely
5% increase in your ability.
Yeah.
Is huge.
Sure is.
Huge. And they don't look at, you know, everybody's watching this Michael Jordan thing. You know, I remember when he was out of baseball, and they had an article in out of basketball, and he was going to come back. And he commented to a writer from Sports Illustrated, he said, well, I'm out of shape. And the writer said, oh, sure, that just means that you're in 10 times better shape than everybody else in the league. You know, Magic. Magic used to dribble a basketball to score with his right hand. On the way home, he would dribble with his left hand. Larry Bird was out on the floor. You know, I remember one beat writer saying Larry Bird was on the floor hours before the game. If you're willing to do that, it's inevitable you're going to have success in this. And that's certainly, and I'm going to ask you this as a coach, because I know this. If a kid doesn't have that, they're worthless, no matter what their talent level. They're not going to contribute. It's going to be an error in the third inning that they're not sharp, they're lazy mentally, they're you would count it on them to be a closer, but they didn't work out in the off season. It's, you know, you have to chase them to go to class. That kid is not an asset. That kid is somebody that you have to chase to perform.
You have to turn around and you have to have a very serious man-to-man, eyeball-to-eyeball conversation about the reality of where that kid is at with you and your program. And if there's not going to be a drastic change in your worth ethic as well as your passion for the game, we might very well right now shake hands, say goodbye, good luck to you, and wish you well, because he's not going to move forward in your program. He's not. He is he's going to hit the ceiling. His ceiling will be very low. He'll hit the ceiling. He'll bounce down. Now, if he bounces down and comes back and believes you, you know, sometimes when you talk to players, you know, they take a little time to believe you. You know, it's very concerning. If you're not going to believe me, who are you going to believe when I talk to you?
Well, you know, the human animal, just like a dog or a horse or anything else, is punishment reward.
No question.
The carrot or the stick.
Yeah,
that's right. I'm going to tell you an interesting story. I had a kid, and this goes back several years ago. And this kid could fall out of bed and throw 92.
Yeah.
Just natural, you know. Fall out of bed and throw 92. Could take 2 years off, fall out of bed, eat a pizza, and throw 92 miles an hour. And he had I won't mention any names. He had a full ride at a strong D2 program.
Yep.
So he went to that. Now, because of his talent, in his mind, he's going to be in Yankee Stadium next week. And so instead of going to class, he went to Budweiser University. And listen to this. He flunked out. His grade point was zero.
Yep.
Zero. And he gained 20 pounds, and it wasn't fat. It wasn't hard muscle. It was fat.
Yep.
And, you know, he came to me, and he, because he flunked out, that was the epiphany. He hit the floor with a thud. Now, again, this is a kid that as a freshman, 92. And, you know, so I mean, I would project, you know, 95, he was a, you know, he had certainly professional arm potential. You know, I called 30 schools. 30. And they knew him. And I couldn't get a taker.
You couldn't get a taker.
I could not get anybody. I finally got a favor. I finally got a favor from a friend of mine who was also, in addition to a coach, he was an assistant AD. I finally got a favor, and to his credit, the kid came back and he went to school. He went to a community college, got his grades up to 3.0.
Yep.
And showed that he was going to be a student and knuckled down, lost the weight.
Mm-hmm.
And he contributed, got a strong partial scholarship. But think about that. Here's a kid that probably had 40 schools after him, and he called, and they go, no, they're not interested. It shows you how important all those character elements are when you choose players.
Yes, that's true. But it also shows you that this kid was smart enough to realize I am in serious trouble here. I need someone to talk to. I need someone I can trust. I need someone who's going to give me a very fair evaluation that I stink, you know, that I have hit the rock bottom. I threw 92 coming out of high school. I got lit up in college. It was all about my off the field Bud Light or Bud Heavies, whatever you want to say. It was all about that. And now I realize that I want a second chance. But it goes to show you that someone that you trusted you.
Right.
You know, if you know someone and you trust that person and they say, listen, I've got a kid who needs a second chance. Lots of players need second chances. There are guys today in the big leagues. There's only 750 guys in the big leagues this afternoon. There are stories inside those 750 guys that those guys got a second chance because someone trusted them. And you got that kid a second chance. Now, I don't know if he went on to college, if he did well, as long as he graduated. And
yeah, no, he did fine.
He reached his goal. But it was because of the trust factor is the key factor in all of this, Carl.
You know, and it boils down to, and I want to end on this because I want to put this out and get some response so we can have people asking specific questions about their specific individual situation. But what it boils down to is, number one, this is not a fantasy. This is reality. Baseball at the college and professional level is a business, and it's a hard business. You better know the reality. Number two, you better take responsibility for your own life. And number three, you better get somebody that will make an accurate evaluation and guide you through the process. With, you know, I can't tell you that I've even had kids say to me, oh, if it's not a Division I school, I'm not going to play. Jeez.
Don't say that.
Jeez.
Yeah. There are national champions at the Division I level. There are national champions at the Division II level. There are national champions at the Division III level. There are Division I schools in this country that refuse to play the national Division III teams in this country because they don't want to get beat. It happens. On a particular day in a 9-inning game, I can run anybody out there, you know. It's the quality of the play and the consummate coaching piece that is the difference. And I'm convinced about that. At any level you have, you still got to cross that little white line and get three outs. You could cross that white line and not come back for an hour and a half. So you have to determine. I'm convinced of this, Carl. I'm convinced that there's a school for every player.
I agree.
Really,
I agree with you.
Whether it be a Division I, II, or III school, could be a junior college.
Absolutely.
An NAIA school.
I agree.
I mean, there are NAIA schools in the middle of the country that could come east here and beat a lot of Division I schools here in the east. There's no question about that. You know, people are not aware of the fact of how good these college teams are, whether they be in the NCAA or the NAIA or the top junior colleges in this country. You know, you're talking about great clubs. You really are. You're talking about outstanding players and outstanding teams that have gotten there because of the dedication of the people recruiting them. And they're trying to tell the truth.
I did a forum on scouting several years ago, and we had Chris Carminucci there, who was the who's a scout for the Diamondbacks. I'll tell you a couple of quick stories. When I played at a division, I played football at Division I school. Now, there's 120 guys on that team. Dan, I'm walking along the sidelines because I had transferred there, and I'm looking for somebody that I'm better than. And you go, oh, where'd you go? They're all state.
Oh, sure.
All conference.
That's right.
It's that level. And something else that you and I are pointing out, when you go in there, you're an 18-year-old freshman. There are guys that have already been successful playing at that level for 2-3 years. And they're not going to go, oh, yeah, come on down. You can take my position, of course. They're not going to do that.
You're about to get bruised up a little bit.
And we have a mutual friend, Bill Holowaty.
Great man.
You know, Eastern was a powerhouse. And yep. They used to scrimmage D1 schools, and they beat the pants off of them.
That's correct. There's a very good example of a Division III school in the Northeast here that won 5 NCAA Division III national championships.
Absolutely.
You know, you're talking about not only quality players, but quality people. You mean Bill Holowaty, Frank Vieira, Andy Balock,
right.
John Winken. You know, you're talking about people that it was more important that they develop the character of the player than they develop the player itself, because they did a great job developing the player itself.
You know, when I was a kid, I remember Winken winning, you know, they won nationally. And everybody in college baseball is going, Maine, how the hell did they do this? It's snowing in July.
That's correct. Not too many people know his secret of how he did it. A very unique individual that had 3 or 4 people on his side financially that basically financed his trips around the country. And
also he did, he just full bore poured into the other thing, which is, you know, they did, hours and hours and hours of breaking down things into detail.
Oh, yeah.
What's called short drills.
Oh, sure. No question about it. He was a great – John Winken is one of my all-time favorite guys. I had a chance to coach against him for 5 years when I was at the University of Hartford. You know, and he broke it down. He broke the technique down into such small drills. And then at the end of the drills, he put everything together, and it felt like it was just a glove that was right on your hand. You know,
interesting.
He's a very special person.
There's another guy that's a friend of mine, Steve Trimper, who's at Stetson.
Correct.
He was at Maine for a while. Same type of thing. Really, if he wasn't a baseball guy, you'd want to be friends with this guy. A lot of integrity, good guy, all that type of thing. I want to say one other thing.
And he also came out of the Eastern Connecticut program with Bill Holowaty.
Yes, he did. That's right. I forgot.
Correct.
You're
right.
Absolutely right.
Right.
And I'll tell you something else that I didn't realize until I got into this more, is when you do that stuff, you know, then you never think of yourself as a failure. You're able to dissect that part of the full movement that you did that you can fix. Mentally, there is no failure. there's just information that makes that can make you better if you look at it that way, if you perceive it that way.
That's correct. You also, you know, when you break down the game and the technical piece of the game and you break it down into steps, you're going to take that player out as far out as he can go with his ability level, so that he may not be the best player on your team, but he's a better player than before he walked in with you. That's the key ingredient. You know, he may not be that surgeon that you're looking for in brain surgery, but he might be the guy that can sew up a stitch on a wound or something. You know, you turn around and you take that kid as far out as he can go with his ability that God has blessed him with.
I've got a minor league pitcher right now, and I've talked him through this. He's been having a really neat individual because he was drafted out of high school.
Mm-hmm.
And 34th round, so he said, well, I'm gonna go to a small college. And he went up, and he got up to the 22nd round. Mm-hmm. Looking back on it, he'll tell you that was a mistake. You know, he was ascending. He should have kept with that ascension. Okay. But he went, he was in the Mariners system, and he just was too young and too immature to be able to dissect when he had a problem, how to fix it. And he came up, I know you're friendly with my partner with Dave Scrivens from the Red Sox. He came up to us at a tryout, and he didn't make excuses. He said, this is what happened, and he took responsibility for that. Now he's pitching for Sussex in the Can-Am League. And I'll tell you, and this goes to the thing we're talking about, is he's in an environment where he's right at 92. Now, what he's looking for, of course, the 95, 97 is going to ring up the bells and whistles and get everybody. But I told him, I said, stop looking for something you don't have at the moment. You'd probably get there. But dominate with what you got.
Exactly.
Dominate, win the ball game. Dominate with what you've got. He's got a sink. He's got a cross seam two, a four seam, a change, and a curve. And I said, okay, I want you to visualize executing that best pitch.
Right.
Whatever that is. I said, if you have even three of those working on individual day at your top level, what are you going to do in that league? You're going to dominate.
No question about it. Total dominant.
And you think I can't make a phone? I said, come to me after a month and tell me you've had three outings where you've struck out 12 in seven innings. You think I can't make a phone call? Come on.
Of course you can. And you know, the piece to that is very important that he realizes is, what is my best pitch today? What is my best pitch today that I have in my bag? I'm going to go out and win. Because when I get to 2-2 in the count, I'm coming after you with my very best pitch that I have in my bag today. It might not be the best pitch tomorrow I had, but today it's the best pitch because it's always about the next pitch. So if I throw a ball at 2-2 with my best pitch, I'm coming back at you with my very best pitch again, because I'm going to win or lose with my best pitch. And you're right. If you can convince him of that, that's all part of the maturity factor that a young guy has, as well as the thought process of how to be successful. You're teaching a kid not only to realize what my best attributes are, but I can be successful today with what you gave me, armed me with.
I want to tell you, I want to end with for today. We'll get back to this, but I want to end today with this. We both know Dave, both from the Red Sox.
Outstanding guy.
Yes, he is. So
outstanding teacher.
I was standing, well, he's also a D1 cross country coach, which is Charles Skips as well.
Yeah, I didn't know that.
I'm standing with him, and this kid walks, this young man, he's not a kid, he's got a wife and a child. He walks up to me. And he starts talking to the two of us. And you know, without even seeing a pitch, you know what Dave told me impressed about him about this young man? He didn't make excuses.
No excuses, right.
He didn't say, oh, they didn't treat me well and they shafted me in this. Right. He took responsibility. And Dave said, now, and I will tell you one last thing also. You know, the kid that we helped get drafted 2 years ago, Dave – came and watched him play.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Now, Dave had to leave to go to a pro game. You know what Dave saw? Two at-bats.
So two at-bats.
Didn't get a hit. He walked both times, and Dave walked. I said, what do you think? He says, great discipline, very mature, very, you know, controlled, doesn't, you know, very, you know, that people don't understand. People don't.
They don't understand the fact that there's somebody saw something very special. Now, he could walk twice on eight pitches, and there would be people that didn't even feather the guy. But here's a guy that watched him at his at-bat, maybe take two or three pitches that were very close, that were balls, and it stuck with him and grabbed him. You know, there's something about what you did today on the field. I gotta see you again. See, I have to see you again because I'm convinced that you have something special that I see, and I got to convince myself of that.
And this is what I'm talking about overall. In this environment, take responsibility for yourself.
No question about it.
Get information. And thirdly, understand what goes on at the next levels, college and pro ball. It's all this minutia. It's this and this.
No question about it.
You come with that. I'll teach you the rest of the stuff. We'll figure a way.
And I was just going to say to you, I think you're absolutely right. There are young people today that are looking for reasons why they're not successful. And all they have to do is look in the mirror, and if they don't make any excuses, they're going to start on a solid foundation. Don't allow anyone to convince you that an excuse is acceptable. It's not. There are no acceptable excuses. None. We're going to fight through this and make this work.
I don't know if you know, I grew up in the horse business.
Oh, is that right?
I trained horses professionally, and I'm back in it. I work with, as a skills coach, I'm going to go back and train my partner in that business. Is one of my best friends for decades. He's a Hall of Fame cutting horse trainer. And there, when he was learning how to do this, he was working with a top trainer. And he used to go to the guy and he would say, I got a problem with my horse. And the guy would say, tie the horse up, go into my house, go into the bathroom and look in the mirror.
Yep. There you go. You got the point across, right?
Yeah, there's your problem.
There's your problem. Yeah.
Anyway, my friend, thank you very much. I don't know what anybody else, but I enjoyed the hell out of this. This is a lot of fun to do this.
Thank you very much. You're very gracious inviting me. Thank you. I really respect that and appreciate it. And believe me, I'm very grateful.
Well, you know, I've been doing this for so long. You see so many kids. Like, I want people to understand that our successes have been almost 100% kids that would fall through the cracks.
Yeah.
And because they weren't given the information, but they had this and this. And you said it yourself. I have yet to see a kid that can't play college baseball that has come to me. You know, and if they're willing to listen and they have this and this, we're going to find a place for them.
And you will find a place for them. And the school that you're going to contact, believe me when I tell you, once you develop a personal and professional relationship, they will buy into what you are providing
Absolutely.
To them. Absolutely. They will, because they're going to trust you. They're going to trust you.
Well, again, not only thank you, but I look forward to more of this. I'll keep in touch, and we'll get this up and see where it goes with it.
Carl, thanks a million.
Oh, my pleasure.
Good luck with your horse training, my man.
I knew you didn't know that.
See you at Aqueduct.
Yeah, I was at South Carolina this year. I spoke at a huge, there's a thing called the Equine Affair. I've spoken at that thing. That's 150,000 people at this damn thing. It's in Springfield.
That's great.
So, yeah, I really, I miss the lifestyle. So, thanks again. We'll be in touch.
Good luck. Thank you.